Hi, this is Chelsea from Ref and Write. In this video, we will learn how to write the results section of your research paper. This is a relatively easy section to write. You simply have to organize your results and write them up in a logical sequence. This section typically contains the following components. You can start this section with some information about data preprocessing. You can also talk about any difficulties you encountered while collecting or processing the data. Then you can start presenting your main findings in a logical sequence. When reporting your results, you must try to use descriptive statistics and inferential statistics to present your data. For example, mean, standard deviation, confidence intervals, p-value, etc. You must try to present your results in figures and tables wherever possible. This is a fantastic way to summarize large amounts of data in a visually pleasing way. You must highlight any important trends and patterns in the data. Trends and patterns describe the general change in some variable in relation to another variable. Finally, you can talk about any reanalysis of data you had to perform in order to reconfirm your findings. Let's look at some examples. Here is an example from an engineering research paper where the authors talk about pre-processing. The authors are saying that they performed a series of steps before conducting the actual analysis. They are saying that they filled in the missing data using linear interpolation, and then they transformed and normalized the data. Finally, they applied data smoothing to remove any noise in the data. As you can see, the authors are very transparent and are detailing everything they did to the data before the actual analysis. Let's look at some examples of how to present your main findings. While presenting your findings, you must clearly explain 1. What did you find? 2. What did you not find? 3. What did you find that you were not expecting? This is an example from a psychology research paper. In this paper, the authors are investigating the effects of different types of music on people. The authors say that they found significant differences between classical and pop music in terms of memory recall. And then they are saying that they did not find any differences in terms of emotional response. Finally, they are saying that they were quite surprised to find that both types of music fatigued the listeners at the same rate. It is very clear from their tone that the last result was a bit unexpected. You can see that the authors have presented their findings in an unbiased manner without any interpretation. They have listed the positive, the negative, and the neutral results logically in the text. This is how it should be done. Now let's look at another example. This snippet is from a social sciences research paper investigating the relationship between social media and mental health. I want you to pay specific attention to the descriptive and inferential statistics used throughout the text. The authors say that there is a significant difference in anxiety levels between high social media users and moderate social media users. Since the authors have used the word significant, they have specified the p-value of the statistical test they used to ascertain this. Then they are providing the actual values of the amount of time spent by both groups on social media. They have presented the data in the form mean plus or minus standard deviation, which is the standard specific way to represent this type of data. In the final statement, they talk about the odds of both groups experiencing sleep disturbances. They have provided the odds ratio along with the confidence intervals. The use of relevant statistics is very important while writing your results section. It offers 2 benefits. Number 1, it will help you summarize the data in a meaningful way, and number 2, it will make your text sound more credible. Here is an example where authors are reporting the results of a questionnaire study related to people's shopping behavior. The authors have presented the results in a variety of ways. They have used the percentage response to present the main findings. Pay attention to how the authors are very selective in terms of what they have presented in the text. They are just letting the readers know what were the first, second, and last ranked options rather than talking about all the options, because this is likely to be more interesting to the readers. If they want more information, the readers can always refer to the table that contains the full data. The authors have used average response instead of percentage response to present the next set of results. They are saying that on average, the participants were fairly confident about shopping online. I want you to pay specific attention to the use of phrases like the majority of respondents, less than half, the average response was. The authors are using these phrases to simplify the narrative for the readers rather than just providing the numbers. Your goal while writing this section should be to present your results as clearly as possible to your readers. One of the important components of the results section is figures and tables. Try to present your data in figures and tables wherever necessary. One of the common questions asked by students is when should they present the data in figures and tables instead of putting it directly in the text? The best way to answer the question is if you cannot present your data in your text in one or two lines, then you should consider putting it in a figure or a table. Another common question that comes up is how to choose between a figure and a table for presenting the data. The best way to answer this question is if you want to illustrate the trends and patterns in the data, then a figure is the best option. If you want to show the actual values or present a lot of numerical information in your paper, then a table might be the best way to go. Here is an example. Look at the way the authors have used tables and figures to describe their results. In the first couple of lines, they are talking about a trend in their data that relates to the change in temperature over time. They are constantly referring to the figure to get their point across to the readers. And finally, in the last sentence, they are telling the readers that the actual numerical data is provided in the table, and they can refer to it if they want. This is a standard way to use figures and tables in your research paper. I hope you found the video useful. See you in the next video. If you have any questions, please drop a message below. We will answer it as soon as possible. If you are interested in watching the extended version of this training course and learn more about research and academic writing, please visit our Learning Academy. You can find the link in the description below. If you still haven't installed RefnWrite software, please do it. It comes with referencing tools, plagiarism checkers, paraphrasing tools, an academic phrase bank, and many other useful features to help you write your research papers and thesis. You can sign up for free using the link below in the description. Finally, please subscribe to our channel to get future updates. Bye for now.